confess that tonight's story has been driving me nuts. It's been a little study. It's been a little upsetting even. So I just wanted to throw that out there to let you know that beforehand as we work through this and talk about what's going on. But instead of going through all this at once, this is going to be a two-parter. So you'll have to come back next week to see how it ends, right? But I just thought, as I looked at this, it's like, there's really so much going on in here. I didn't want to skip past something, okay? So that's where we are. All right, so let's look at 1 Kings, this is chapter 21. 1 Kings chapter 21. And I'll have some things for you to underline here just to help us kind of connect the dots and some stuff like that. So it says, some time later, there was an incident involving a vineyard belonging to Naboth, the Jezreelite. The vineyard was in Jezreel, close to the palace of Ahab, the king of Samaria. So if you'd underline there, the vineyard is what we're talking about. Belongs to Naboth, that's his. And then where did this happen? In Jezreel. But this is really close to the palace of Ahab. So actually, just that, you know, side by side, that's how close we were to it. So, verse 2 here. Ahab said to Naboth. So we have a conversation here. That's why we underline Ahab and Naboth. So the king went and said to Naboth, let me have your vineyard to use for a vegetable garden, since it is close to my palace. In exchange, I'll give you a better vineyard, or if you prefer, I will pay you whatever it is worth. But Naboth replied, the Lord forbid I should give you the inheritance of my ancestors. All right, so if you'd underline that last statement, the Lord forbid that I should give you the inheritance of my ancestors. Let's look at that statement there just for a second. The Lord forbid that I should give you the inheritance of my ancestors. So God gave them the land of Israel, or he loaned it to them, if you will. So that's what Naboth is referring to, is saying, this is God's land. God is letting me borrow it while I'm here on earth. I can't give it to anybody, because God said, this is for you and for your family. That's why it talks about the inheritance of my ancestors. But look at the reply to the king. You would think there's going to be a little trouble here, because the king came and asked for something that he wants. And then he replied with, well, the Lord said, no, you can't have it. Now, looking at Ahab, we know that he has really been a proponent of Baal, this other god. So Naboth is saying, no, my God, my Lord says, no, you can't have it. The Lord forbids that you would have this land. So that's why I wanted us to talk about what has something that has been stolen from you. Because essentially that's what the king was trying to do, is trying to walk up here, kind of muscle him a little bit, say, hey, I'm taking this. I'm going to take this from you. And Naboth, I'm glad he was smart. I'm not always, you know, not always that quick of a thinker to know what to say there. You know, one of those cases you walk away and an hour later, you I shouldn't have said this instead, right? But, so he comes up and he's really trying to steal this from us. So that kind of really got my mind to thinking, what is it we allow people to steal from us? You know, that robs us of our joy, that robs us of our faith, or maybe even that robs us of who we are. You see, a couple of years ago, on our street, right around 4th of July, so we're kind of on with these people that go up and down our street, and if your car is unlocked, they'll open it, they'll take out whatever they can. Well, this one particular year, a bunch of cassette tapes were taken. Yes, cassette tapes. Yeah, there they are. A bunch of cassette tapes. Do you remember those things, right? Those cassette tapes. Now, these cassette tapes were my wife's. And it's funny, we still talk about it to this day. And this happened a couple years, probably 4 or 5 years ago, that those tapes are irreplaceable to her. Because they were groups of people singing when she was in college, and they actually had a very profound effect on forming her faith. You with me on this so far? Yeah? So even though they're cassette tapes, but we can't find them anywhere. We can't find the music, we can't find the singers anywhere, but when if we go back to it, you know, that was taken from us. There's some other change and some other stuff taken, but that piece was taken from us. So when I think about this story of how the king walked in and just wanted to take something, it wasn't his. And then I love that response. I'm sorry, the Lord says you can't have that. And I think that's a stance that we can take today. I'm sorry, the Lord says no. You can't take my joy. You can't take my safety. You can't take my faith. Don't let your joy be taken. I think this is the one thing that it gets me almost every day. Anybody else here ever had your joy taken or stolen from you? And that usually is the stupidest thing that does it, but it happens all the time. Let's see, I teach 5 classes a day, and I can have great classes all day, and I can get up to the last class of the day, the last 5 minutes, and maybe something goes wrong, or you just dread, you know, going to that class. And then you leave work, and what do you think about for the rest of the night? That class. You don't think about the other 100 kids that were perfect and great and did all their work. You're stuck on that class. So you brood on that all night, you go to bed, you're sleeping, you wake up cranky, and then you get to school, and then you get to those good classes. Oh, you get your joy back, right? And then we hit that again. Same thing goes over and over and over. So you just got to train yourself to not let that happen, right? The devil knows exactly what steals your joy, and so he says, he goes and takes it. He steals your joy. Maybe you could have a wonderful day, and one person walking by says one little thing. Maybe it wasn't even to you. Maybe it's something you overheard. Maybe you weren't even sure you heard it correctly. But it's still enough that it steals your joy, isn't it? So when I read the story, it's like, you know what? We've got to say no. The Lord says no. You can't have my joy. You can't steal it. I'm not going to sit around and worry all weekend and shut down and stay in the house because of something you said or something you've done. Don't let your joy be taken. And then on top of that, don't let your faith be taken. That's the next one. I don't know about you, but there's always things pulling at me to pull me away from church. Have you ever had that? It could be friends, it could be family, it could be work, it could be sports, it could be just being tired. I'm too tired, so I'm not going to open my Bible tonight. Well, things will work out fine. I don't need to pray about it, right? All these things that are being taken from us. Don't let your faith be taken. You know, your faith that you have, it's a personal relationship between you and God. And that is yours. That is yours to develop. It's yours to grow. It's yours to have. And we can't let people come into our lives and kind of chip away at that or take that or even totally remove it. And we have to be aware that that happens. That happens around a lot, doesn't it? So the more we're aware, the more we can be ready to say, I'm sorry, the Lord says no, you can't do that. You can't have that. It's so much a part of me, I won't let that be taken. So there's that whole first thing that Ahab comes to and says, I'm going to take something that I want. And his response, the Lord says, sorry, you can't have it. Right? So verse 4. So Ahab went home. Now, this tells us so much about King Ahab's character here. He went home, sullen and angry, because Naboth the Jezreelite had said, I will not give you the inheritance of my ancestors. And then he laid on his bed, sulking and refused to eat. Yeah. I remember doing that as a 3-year-old, you know. He didn't get his way, did he?
Right.
So he's throwing a little hissy fit right now. He lay on his bed, sulking, and he refused to eat. So his wife comes by, Jezebel, and says, why are you so sullen? Why won't you eat? What's going on, honey? Did you have a bad day at work? I have a feeling that's not how Jezebel would have said it. So he answered her, because I said to Naboth, I told him, sell me your vineyard, or if you prefer, I'll give you another vineyard in this place. But he said, I will not give you my vineyard. Well, he said thing going on, right? Jezebel, his wife, said, "Is this how you act as king over Israel? Get up and eat. Cheer up. I'll get you the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite." So you can read that a couple different ways there, the way she said that. You know, you're having a bad day, honey, I'm going to help you. But we know Jezebel, number one, hates God and hates the prophets of God's so much that she's had them all killed except Elijah. So we know a little bit about her. So I'm guessing this statement is a little bit more demeaning, downgrading. What do you think about that? Come on, get up and eat. Cheer up. I'll get you that vineyard. Let's see how she gets it then. Verse 8. So she wrote letters in Ahab's name, placed his seal on them, and sent them to the elders and nobles who lived in Naboth's city with him. In those letters she wrote, "Proclaim a day of fasting and seat Naboth in a prominent place among the people. But seat two scoundrels opposite him and have them bring charges that he has cursed both God and the king. Take him out and stone him to death." So there's a couple things to underline there. Number one, Jezebel wrote letters in Ahab's name and with the seal. We can just assume Ahab had no idea she did that. Then she concocted a very wicked plan, including two scoundrels. And of course, the ultimate ending of the plan was to take him out and stone him to death. Naboth, we're talking about Naboth here, right? Take Naboth out and stone him to death. So after looking at how Jezebel's handling the situation, even though Jezebel is Ahab's wife, not everyone in our lives has our best interest in mind. Right? Not everyone in our lives has our best interest in mind. Such as Dr. Evil. And that's what you see why this story is so confusing. Maybe it's confusing because it can also touch us so real, like it's just written out of today's papers. The story she concocts and the plan that she concocts, we could literally open up our newspaper tomorrow and read this exact plan happen, couldn't we? Right? And that's why this one was just so, I can't even get the word out, confounding. I don't know what it was. But not everyone in our lives has our best interest in mind. Jezebel is doing what she wants to do to further her own name and her own kingdom. She's doing what she thinks she has to do, and that includes killing somebody. But I can tell you one thing, friends. Not everyone in our lives has our best interest, but God does. But God does. This whole story and everything that's going on right now is because the country, Ahab, has actually led them so far away from God that Elijah has come forward to help them bring them back. But God has our best interest. So if you feel like, well, maybe things are being taken from me or things are being stolen from me, and I'm changing as a person, and I don't like that change. I don't like who I'm becoming. If you've ever been in that situation, maybe you feel like you're in that situation, God has your best interest. God has it. I even talked with a young couple last couple weeks, and things were just falling apart in their lives. Absolutely falling apart. And I got a text from him, so we were talking. He goes, "I don't know what to do. I don't know where to turn to." I said, "Would you do me a favor and read the prodigal son story?" He goes, "Yes. Me and my wife will read it tonight." I said, "Okay." I said, "And let me know what you think." Text me back the answer, and he did. And he goes, "Okay, we read it." And I said, "What was the father's response when the prodigal son came back?" He said, "There was a big party." I said, "There was no yelling or arguing or questioning?" "No." And I said, "Well, who is the father in that story?" And he said, "God." And through just that little conversation, he reclaimed his life back to God, right there on my phone, texting each other with it, you know. It was amazing. It was actually, you know, just absolutely a God intervention there. But God has our best interest. And ever since then, almost every day, he's saying, "You won't believe what happened to me today. You won't believe it." He called me just yesterday. my electricity back on, my bills are paid up, I'm getting a promotion at work. I'm like, good for you. You see, God has our best interest at heart. Verse 11. So the elders and the nobles who lived in Naboth's city did as Jezebel directed. They did as Jezebel directed. In the letters that she had written to them, they proclaimed a fast, seated Naboth, blah, 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 Naboth was cursed. So they took him outside the city and stoned him to death. So they took him outside and stoned him to death. Then they sent the word back to her that says, Naboth has been stoned. Verse 15, as soon as Jezebel heard that Naboth had been stoned to death, he said to Ahab, get up and take possession of the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite, that he refused to sell you. He's no longer alive, but dead. When Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, he got up, went down to take possession of Naboth's vineyard. So they took what wasn't theirs. Wasn't theirs to have. Naboth said, this is the Lord's, you're not to have it. And isn't this curious that Ahab is the king? He has absolutely everything at his disposal, yet he wanted something that wasn't his. Right? He coveted his neighbor's land. He was jealous. He needed it for some reason, even though he had everything else. But he still went to any length to get it. He took what wasn't theirs. And so after I'm reading all this and having these, you know, strange thoughts of all this stuff, you know, what has been taken from me, how do we deal with this and stuff, and then I began to think, well, what is our response? If we're in this situation and something we have seen, even like the young couple I talked to, that, you know, stuff is taken from them, what's my response to that? As somebody who follows God, what is my response? Is it anger? Is it revenge? Is it forgiveness? What am I supposed to do here? Do I just stand up for what's right? Do I not get involved? Because somebody has taken something from somebody else. So the more I look at this, and did you notice we haven't heard from God yet in this story? Did you pick up on that? Even Elijah hasn't been in the story yet. This has just been a response between these two, Ahab, Jezebel, and Naboth. So far to me, this is a story of injustice. It's a lack of fairness. It sure gives me a lot to think about. I hope it gives you a lot to think about. Because this is where we're stopping for tonight. To be continued next week. I think this is a good thing. I don't want us to just rush through the rest of it and go, well, I don't know. I don't know what I'm supposed to do here. But feel free to read the ending. There's a good ending to it. God is involved, and God is working in this story. Just like God is working in your life, God has your best interest at heart. So maybe if something has been taken or stolen from you, God's with you. God's on your side. Let's have a word of prayer tonight, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for bringing us together tonight. Thank you for the story that makes us think. Maybe it makes us think of our own actions. It makes us think of how you worked in the world. It makes us think that this happened so long ago in a setting that's really not that different from ours. But Lord, we do know one thing, that you are with us. You have our best interest. You have given us stuff in our relationship that no one can take. And Lord, will you help us to proclaim that in our lives? That what we have together can never be taken because you say so. It's something you've given just us and that nobody else can have. Lord, be with us this week. Help us to watch out, not only for ourselves, to help us watch out for others, to know when to step in, to know when to step back, to know that you're involved and that you're helping in every single situation. Lord, thank you for everyone here tonight. We know what's going on in their lives, and sometimes it's a chore to get here, but sometimes it's easy. But we know that coming here and being together is what raises us up. to worship you, to talk about your ways in our lives, and to pray together as a body. Lord, be with everyone this week as they go through life with family and friends and jobs and relationships and all that good stuff. Help us to grow closer to you. Help us to never flee, to never run away, but to always know that you're with us, and that we are and be with you at any and all the time. We ask all this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. All right, we're going to pick it up from there next week, so make sure you take that home. Make sure you bring it back. We'll have some extras as well, too. All right, next is our offering time here. The way we do our offering is there's a round, brown basket on your table. Make sure you put in the directory information if you haven't already filled out. We'll be doing that in a couple weeks, though, so if you don't have it filled out, don't worry about it. Drop your offering in there. Pass that basket around the table. And we'd have somebody from your table bring up the basket and just sit anywhere up here on the front of the stage. That'd be wonderful. I want to show you a little video here I put together. We had the Navarre Parade yesterday. Right? Today's Sunday. That was yesterday. Saturday morning. So it was a nice day, a little bit cool, but I shot some video together. After that, Matt will come up, pray over our offering, and sing our last song.